How many of you know that Peter didn't denied Jesus Christ? Raise your hands. Debbie doesn't know it, and she's teaching our children. Oh, no. Okay. So it looks like everybody here knows it. He denied Jesus three different times. Can you imagine a follower of Jesus Christ, a lover of Jesus, the very man who said, "I'll live and I'll die for you, Jesus," the same guy who took out his sword and cut off the ear of the servant of the high priest, the same guy who said, "Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, you're the Messiah, I'm certain of it." And Jesus says, "Wow, Peter, I'm going to build the church on you. I'm going to call you Rock now. No longer are you Simon, but you're Peter. You're a rock, and I'm going to build it." But don't we get just a little bit hard on Peter because of all the things I just said? I mean, how could he deny Jesus? What was he thinking? I want to encourage us today to not be too hard on Peter. And let's see if we can learn some things from his experience. So this morning we're going to look at Mark 14. And I'm going to remind us of verse 54, and then we're going to jump to verse 66. Mark 14, verse 54. Is that the second verse that we looked at last Sunday? And I said we'd be looking at it more this week. Verse 54, Peter followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest. There he sat with the guards and warmed himself at the fire. I just pause there for a minute. Where's Peter? Didn't Mark just a few verses earlier say all the disciples deserted Jesus? That's exactly what he said. And to some extent it happened. Peter and John kind of hold back and they're following. John knows people at the high priest's home, and so John gets entrance, and then has to come back to the door, the gate of the home. There'd be a giant courtyard area. Imagine your property being fenced in and going to a gate and letting people in through that gate, and that's where there would be a person. They'd be large doors, though, not just a little gate that you would enter through. And so the servant allows John in, and John comes back and says, no, I want him to come too. And so Peter comes in, and look where he's at. Standing at the fire next to the guards. What guards? The guards that had arrested Jesus. The guards that had come to the Garden of Gethsemane and there had grabbed Jesus, tied him up, and taken him off to the high priest's house. Those very guards are standing at the fire. Sounds like a coward to me, doesn't it? Does that sound like a coward to you? Standing right next to the guards, warming himself at the fire, moved right into the courtyard, right there to where everything is happening. Now, Jesus is probably up in a room, perhaps. He may be at some other part of the courtyard. We're not exactly sure because of the way these residences were. They could have been inside and probably were because it was nighttime. It would have brought too much commotion if they were out there in the courtyard. Because remember, this is a trial they don't want people to know about. So they take him inside. There would have been windows and things. And the reason why I'm mentioning all this, because you'll remember that Luke, also says that right after the rooster crowed, what does it say? It says that Jesus looked at Peter. Somehow, glancing out a window, he heard the rooster crow. And right across there was a fire. Peter was over there, and he looked and saw him. Let's go on with our text. Mark 14, verse 66. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked closely at him. "You also were with that Nazarene Jesus," she said. But he denied it. "I don't know or understand what you're talking about," he said, and went out into the entryway. When the servant girl saw him there, she said again to those standing around, "This fellow is one of them." Again, he denied it. After a little while, those standing near said to Peter, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean. He began to call down curses on himself, and he swore to them, I don't know this man you're talking about. Immediately the rooster crowed the second time. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken to him. Before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me three times. And he broke down and he wept. I said, don't be too hard on Peter. The first thing I would want you to think about is this. Why? How do we know this story? How do we know that Peter denied him? How do we know it's even true? Could have been made up by somebody, right? Who was present to hear the denial? Anybody know? Let's see. John was nearby, but it doesn't appear that he was actually standing there with Peter. Because notice, even in the questions, they're not to, hey, you guys, the two of you there, weren't you with him? Didn't we see you, the both of you in the garden? Both of you are Galileans, right? Like, notice that that's not in it, is it? Nowhere do we hear that John's nearby Peter. He had kind of more privilege, so he had gotten in farther. We don't know how far, but he had gotten in farther. Peter's out here at a fire that's out at the edge, like almost out by the wall. He's warming himself, staying nearby. So how do we know that Peter denied Jesus? We know it because Peter told us. I think that's significant. Peter is the one that's telling us, I denied Jesus Christ. Even after Jesus warned me it was going to happen, even after Jesus said, Peter, don't let yourself be tempted. You know, Satan's trying to sift you. Even after Jesus said, Peter, can't you just stay awake and pray a little bit? Peter tells us, after all of that, after all the experiences I had with Jesus, I walked on water with Jesus. I saw him feed the hungry with thousands of people with a few loaves of bread and fish. I was out there when he healed the sick. I actually was up on the mountain when we saw Elijah and Moses come visit with him. I had such amazing experiences, and yet I denied him. I broke his heart. Might as well have rejected him. I might as well have betrayed him just like Judas. I denied him too. Don't be too hard on Peter. Because he's a man who's able to admit his guilt, who's able to face his failures, and also, notice, we're going to get to the end of the story later, but come back to Jesus too. Don't we all sin against God? Surely not as bad as Judas or as bad as Peter, though, right? No, if you think about it, you would be able to come up with times that you've denied Jesus too. Times that you kept silent. Times that, well, there's people watching, so you don't pray at dinner in the restaurant. Times that you cursed and hollered out something, GD or even Jesus Christ or some other nasty term. If you think about it, there's all kinds of ways that we've sinned and that we've done just as bad as what Peter did. Romans 7, verses 14 to 25. Paul says, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual. I appreciate the fact that Paul is very I-centered in these verses. Notice, he doesn't use what most of us tend to do. Yeah, we all sin. And we're going to confess what we all do. Have you ever confessed somebody else's sin like that? It's a lot easier to confess we. You know, we deny, we betray, we reject, we turn against God. But when you put the I in there, you've got to face your own behavior. And look at what Paul says. He says, we know that the law is spiritual, there's the we, but I am unspiritual. Sold as a slave to sin, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. as it is no longer I myself who do it, but is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that it is my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? And then Paul makes the switch that, oh, thank you, Jesus. Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature, a slave to the law of sin. We all sin, Paul says. And he says, I do it. And I constantly get into this battle of doing the very things I don't want to do. And sin is controlling. And then notice that one point where he said, and evil's right there. Evil's right there. Now notice, Paul doesn't say, and therefore the devil made me do it. No, no. He just says evil's right there. He's gotten the point that Peter got as well. Peter, Satan's right next to you. He's wanting to sift you. He's wanting to destroy you. He's wanting to harm you. He's wanting to discourage you. He's wanting to beat you up. He's wanting to entice you enough that you'll reject forgiveness and my love. Peter, be careful. Paul, evil's right there, lurking right next to me. And the things I want to do, I fail at. Things I don't want to do, I continue to do them again and again. But thanks be to God, because God wants to give us life. You know, as you, if you think about it, doesn't one small sin lead to another? Whatever, and if you don't need to go into your habit right now. I don't want you to get too much negative thinking right now. But the fact is that adultery was never committed just with one moment's act. Adultery started because of a conversation that went longer than it should have. Adultery continued because of the conversation that, well, I'd kind of like to talk to that person some more. Adultery grows as it'd be fun to, I wonder if he or she's out there. Are they getting coffee right now? Oh, look, they're there. Maybe I'll go out and get coffee too. And adultery takes these little steps that go farther and farther and deeper into the depths of sin, which is ultimately betrayal of a loved one and giving in to something that you'd committed yourself never to do. One small sin leads to another. Barclay said, make no mistake, Peter fell to a temptation which would have come only to a man of fantastic courage. Why do I say that? Where are the other disciples? They're gone. They're already afraid and in hiding. Yeah, John's there, the beloved, but he's also pretty quiet right now. We don't hear anything. We never hear anything about what happened while he was there and when he left or anything like that. It took a courageous man to stand next to those soldiers, those guards who had actually arrested Jesus. And in fact, we're going to find in one of our texts, it says that one of the servants, relatives of Malchus, who had his ear cut off, John's the one who tells us this, one of the relatives of Malchus is one of the soldiers standing there by the fire that Peter moves to and says, hey, didn't I see you out there where we arrested this guy? Now, what would you respond? This is not a wicked Peter. His denial is not a thought-out act of betrayal. He didn't plan to go in there like, okay, let's see, tonight I'm going to go to Caiaphas' house. going to get next to the guards, and then I'm going to tell them I don't believe in Jesus. I'm going to call down curses from heaven. He had no plan in that regard. Peter is trying to watch and see what happens to Jesus. He wants to know this man that he loves, and he knows he's heard it enough. Jesus has said he's going to be killed, crucified by both Rome and the Jewish leaders. Handed over to them. He's already told them all this. Peter's got it. So with head covered, trying to remain anonymous, incognito, not wanting anyone to say anything to him. He's a child hiding, not wanting someone else to say, "Oh, Billy's hiding over there. You'll find him over there around the corner. Go get him," for the child that's playing hide and seek. Don't you hate that when somebody gives you up when you're hiding? That's Peter. He doesn't want to be found out because he wants to be as close as he possibly can be to Jesus, even in this terrible, evil night. But sin starts small. Hey, you there. Weren't you with him? Oh, no, not me. He's trying to hide here. Just see you later. And he moves to another place. 1 Corinthians 5:6 says, "Your boasting is not good. Don't you know that a little yeast leavens the whole batch of dough?" It's just a little bit of yeast that causes the dough to start to rise and will then ruin it in the sense as Jesus refers to it, as James is trying to tell us, as 1 Corinthians Paul is mentioning. James goes on and gives us a similar thought. He says in James 1:12-16, "Blesses the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. When tempted, no one should say, 'God is tempting me.'" You might want to highlight that in your Bible. God doesn't tempt us. The temptation comes from inside of us. How did Paul say it earlier? From the sin that's just residing there. The sinful desires that I have. "For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin." What was Peter's desire? I got to hide. I got to not keep, make sure that nobody knows that I'm here. Desire, after it's conceived, gives birth to sin. So weren't you there? Weren't you one of his? Oh, no, not me. First sin. And now the path. The door has been open, and he started to follow this path. "Then after desire is conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death." So someone else asks, "Hey, I'm sure, didn't we see you out there?" Oh, no. And then finally, "Yeah." And Peter, he can't keep it quiet, can he? So even standing next to the fire, even around all these guards, even these people he's trying to blend in. The problem is he has an accent. So imagine somebody from the South trying to blend in right now. Okay? And they're talking in a way that does make it. You say, I really don't fit into this place here. I'm really different than these people. Or what's the other words? What's that? So Peter, by his very conversation, gives himself away. Immediately the rooster crowed the second time. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken to him. "Before the rooster crows twice, you will disown me three times." And he broke down and wept. Luke says he ran outside, probably left the courtyard, and broke down and cried bitterly. Peter's remembering the words of that Jesus said, "Too late." What would have happened if he had remembered those words throughout the night? I need to be on my guard in here, not just because there's guards around here. I need to be on my guard because Jesus said, this is when I'm going to deny him. So Lord, you help me. Lord, you keep me focused. Lord, you help me to not make that mistake. I know Satan's here. I know Satan wants to mess me up, but Jesus, you help me so that that doesn't happen. Wouldn't it made a difference for Peter? And when he remembered, Peter broke down and wept. Matthew says he wept bitterly. I looked at that word for weeping to just say, oh, so where else is it used in the New Testament? Well, here's an interesting one. Remember what happened as Jesus is coming down from the Mount of Olives to enter into Jerusalem, the final week, the Holy Week? And he looks out over Jerusalem, and it says that Jesus starts to weep. Luke 19:41, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it. He starts to weep as he looks at the city that he knows he's going to be dying for. And he knows that they're going to reject him. He knows they've been rejecting him. And he's wanted to bring them under his arms. He's wanted to draw them in. He's wanted them to love him. But he won't force it. And he knows that the end of the week is going to be total rejection and death on a cross. And so he weeps. He weeps for their decision to reject him. Here's another place. We'll see it in a couple of weeks. As Jesus is carrying his cross through Jerusalem out to Golgotha. It says that the women of Jerusalem began to weep. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and your children." Imagine women watching this body all torn up. Flesh is just obliterated. He's a bloody mess, okay? He's been beat. He's been whipped. He's been tortured. And he's carrying this cross. And if you've got any ounce of sympathy and compassion inside of you and you're watching this, you are going to be a mess yourself. And here's an interesting place. John 20. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." It's Mary in the garden on Easter Sunday morning. And she's weeping because she's going there to dress his body to finish the burial process, and his body has been taken, and all she can think of is more grief on the grief she's already feeling. This is Mary, who with her Jesus' mother, Mary, watched Jesus die on that cross. She saw him say, "It's finished." She saw him give up his spirit. She saw the death. She's still agonizing now over that just 3 days later. And she's weeping there, "Please, where is he? Tell me and I'll get him." Then there's one other verse that I thought was fitting for us. There's several, but the one other one I thought was fitting was when in Romans 12:15, when Paul says, "Rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn." They say that pastors are supposed to remain professional when they do funerals and things like that, right? And when you do a funeral for somebody that you care about, and I can remember family members doing the memorials, close friends I've cared about, people I've loved, my nephew and others. And frankly, I allow myself and I don't demand that I can't be emotional. And there will be moments, well, I'll be able to do the service, but there will be moments where the tears will simply be there and naturally there. And Paul says it so well. We rejoice with those who rejoice. There ought to be a mutual celebration when good things are happening in someone else's life. But there's also, we ought to be able to feel one another's pain. I mean, doesn't that take relationship building? Doesn't that take time? I mean, I look around the room and there's things that I know some of you have been going through. I look at somebody who's not sitting back there in that corner. Denny asked about Pete this morning. And I know that there's a day coming when we will celebrate the fact that Peter's in heaven. God wants us to have the kind of relationships with one another that we know enough about each other to be able to rejoice, but we also care enough about one another to be able to weep with each other. And if I could just put this one little note in there, this one caveat, it's why I believe in us doing life groups. It's why I want us gathering in homes. It's why I want us to have those personal times together. Because the fact is that I can read your prayer request on a prayer sheet, but when I'm sitting next to you and you're sharing the story of what you're going through, when you're celebrating something that we've been praying about for weeks with you, and then you come and say, look what God did for me, there is a relational blessing that we get that we can't have sitting here. Unless you all would start getting billboards that you would carry on your back, or flashing signs that you carry on your head, or you know, hook up your iPads to one another so we can all see what's going on in your life, so we know how much you're hurting or how much you're celebrating, how much you're at joy, how much you're at peace, how much good things are happening, how tough things are happening. Unless you're going to somehow wear all that, then we need to take the time to build relationships with one another. And by the way, you're all invited to life groups, okay? The bulletin has an invitation in it, and you're all invited, and I want you all to know that. Don't ever feel like you can't come because you're not allowed, you haven't gotten the special permission. If you want to come to my house, you're all invited to my house, okay? And we'll sit on each other's lap to make room if we have too many. Okay. I have heard, though, that the Monday night group has the best desserts, so I don't know. Let's go back to Peter for a minute. When he remembered what Jesus said, it broke him. When we remember the word of God, it may break us. I've sinned. And even though God forgets and forgives our sins, guess what? You know who has the long memory? It's not your neighbor. It's you. You're the one who remembers what you've done. We forgot it long time ago. Even if you came in and confessed it in detail, it's like, out of our brains. But you're the one who remembers. God says, as far as the sins are from the east, it's from the west. That's far. How far is he? He's removed them from us. And the amazing thing is, we have a God who forgets. Because he forgives. You see, folks, our denial may be subtle in its approach, but we know when we've denied Jesus. Are you one of his disciples? Well, I don't want people to see that I read my Bible or that I pray. I don't want to offend anyone with talking about Jesus. Besides, they're probably not interested in God anyways. And I have so many other things to do right now. Isn't that all settled denial? John MacArthur said, a disciple wants to follow to follow close. You want to stay close to Jesus. That was Peter. But you boasted too much, listened too little, prayed too little, acted too little, too fast, followed too far, and as a result, Peter fell too low. Darkest hour in human history, hell's hour, Jesus was on trial, about to be executed, and Peter is no match for the forces of hell. And I guess I would just say to us, when we boast too much, see, it's Peter's self-confidence. Oh, I'll be fine, Jesus. You know, come on, man. I'm going to go out there and die for you, so no big deal, right? I'm going to leave here today, and I'm going to tell everybody about Jesus. You know, I'm not going to hold back until the first person complains. When we boast too much, when we listen too little, we pray too little, we act too fast, and we too may fall too low. The sad thing is that when we do that, what do we tend to do to ourselves? We beat up ourselves with sin. We beat ourselves up. Too often, we remember the warning not to sin after we've already sinned. Oh yeah, that's what I was not supposed to do. We remember that God will provide a way out. He won't allow us to be tempted beyond what we can bear, but He'll provide a way out. And we forgot, oh, I forgot to take the way out. And we look back and we see the mistakes that we made. Can you imagine what that whole week was like for Peter? It had to be excruciating. I've seen some plays where they try to give us a little bit of the image of Peter's experience, and other disciples are coming up to Peter, and Peter, we've seen him. He's alive again, Peter. Come on, it's time to celebrate, man. I'm like, yeah, right. Not celebration for me, because there's, and if he is alive again, oh, Lord, help me. I'm going to have to face him after I denied him. Do you know the last look that he gave me? Was that look of love and sadness when I cursed heaven and myself and said I didn't know him. The week had to be horrible for Peter. It's what amazes me that it's Peter who tells us the story. Yeah, I'm that courageous guy. I pulled out my knife. I was the one, when everyone else was just standing there watching and starting to run, I grabbed my knife, I cut it. I tried to cut his throat, but I missed, and I cut off that guy's ear. I was ready to die. I went in there to that courtyard. I wasn't afraid to be there. I was just trying to stay nearby, and so I had to continue to conceal my identity. Until it went too far, and I broke his heart. And I guess what I would say to us today is that our sin should break us. It should break us. Lord, help us if it doesn't. If we sin and like, you know, oh well, okay, another sin, no big deal. Or if we, oh no, I didn't sin. When God knows it was. I read earlier from Psalm 32. David said, when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. There's a benefit to that sapping. There's a benefit to God's hand being heavy upon us. There's a benefit for us to feel, oh no, I've blown it. Sin should break us. What's the benefit? Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. That's the benefit of being broken. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. I'm not going to lie about it, God. I sinned against you. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, verse 5, and did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. It's Psalm 51, verse 4. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. And then verse 17, my sacrifice, O God. Watch this one. David is saying, okay, God, I've sinned against you. He's not downplaying the significance of his sin against Bathsheba or the sin against his wife Michael or the sin against his future child that will then die. He's not downplaying that at all. What he's saying is that all that was so bad that my sin against you was worst of all. Because I really rejected you, God. I turned on you. And then in verse 17, but my sacrifice, O God, did you catch this? Is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, you, God, will not despise. Folks, our sin should break us. And it's the way to forgiveness. How many of you have seen the movie Hacksaw Ridge? Oh, good. A number of you. Very, very moving story, isn't it? Very bloody movie and all. Very, a lot of things very real to life in it. But one of the moving parts that I appreciated was after the young man is down the mountain, he's brought in all these soldiers that he's rescued, and he's in there, I think, being taken care of. Actually, he's outside now. And the captain of his company, who was just brutal to him throughout the process, you know, less than a man, treated him like he was a nothing, you know, tried to force him out of the army. He comes to him and he says, "I hope that someday you will be able to forgive me. All I saw was this skinny guy. I didn't see the man inside of you." Very moving. For me, it was one of those moving moments, and there's a lot of stuff in it. But notice what I appreciated about that is that this captain had to come to breaking himself in order to now come and even hope that someday he would be forgiven. We have to be broken by our sin, friends. But the good news, the incredible news, the wonderful news is that even when Peter denies Jesus, Jesus forgives him. Even when we deny Jesus, Jesus forgives us. Even when we break his heart, Jesus forgives us. Luke says that Jesus looked at Peter and then Peter remembered what Jesus had warned him. Jesus is up there. They've started the abuse of him. Who knows where it exactly was during the trial? Probably before they've actually put the hood over Jesus' head and punched him, but they've already been punching him, beating him, and mean to him and stuff. And he's heard the rooster crow once. He's probably been silent during this part of the conversation and the hearing and all the lies and stuff like that. But even in the silence and even in the lies that he hears the rooster crow a second time. And he looks across. You can almost imagine the high priest saying, "Aren't you going to say anything? Aren't you going to respond to these charges?" As Jesus looks across and he catches the eye of Peter. "I am. And you will see the Son of Man coming." Jesus declares that he is God and he will judge, and he has the right to judge that man out there that just denied him. And instead, he will die for him and invite him to come and accept his forgiveness. Any of you ever go to Starbucks? Never? Too bad. I'm not allowed to drink caffeine right now, but my son, Philip, has been, when he and Jen go to another state, did you know that Starbucks has their own Starbucks mugs that are identified for a particular state, sometimes even a community? And so Philip has been doing this where he and Jen will go somewhere, he buys a Starbucks mug. And he has something like, I think now about 15 or so of them, something like that. Well, the other day we're at his house and he's stacking them up like this, one on top, because they have like this little ridge and they can kind of stack on top of that. And it's up here, it's higher, it's higher, it's higher. I'm like, Philip, be careful. Philip, don't do that. Philip, something's going to, and about that time it's, you know, kaboom. And at least three or four of the mugs broke. And I put my finger in the middle of his chest and I said, "See you." No, I didn't. Didn't need to say anything because his wife's over there. At a recent life group, we were talking about betrayal. And Debbie described one of her deepest pains was the pain of betrayal. And I grieve the ways that over our life that I betrayed her. And betrayal comes in all shapes and sizes. Maybe a subtle glance, a lingering temptation, a fantasy played out, a broken promise. Silence when there should be affirmation. Each of us can so easily deny Jesus. And when we really get it, it will break your heart. John 21. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he had raised from the dead. Verse 15, when they had finished eating, I probably should have set the stage for you. This is about a week after Jesus has first risen from the dead. Jesus is out on the lakeside. The disciples have been out fishing because they're kind of just that's what fishermen do. And Jesus tells them, hey, throw your nets on the other side. And they do that. And they get this big haul of fish. And Peter says, that's got to be the master. And he jumps out of the boat and starts swimming in to shore to see Jesus. He gets in there. And Jesus already has a fire going. I think he even already had some fish cooking. And he serves them breakfast. And after breakfast is over, Jesus says, hey, Peter. Peter, let's go for a walk. I don't know if it had been you, if you'd been Peter, what you might have been feeling in that moment. Oh, here it comes. Okay, I've been glad he's alive, and I've been celebrating that sort of. But now, okay, now I've got to face him. Oh, I'm in big trouble. And I just think, with all the love of heaven, Jesus takes Peter aside, and look at what he does for Peter. Verse 15, when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. Third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. When you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. And then he said to him, follow me. What Jesus is doing for Peter is so amazing. Peter has denied Jesus three times. So Jesus, and by the way, clarification of the Greek words for love. The first time Jesus says, Peter, do you agape me? Are you willing to sacrifice your life for me? And Peter says, hey man, I've got phileo love for you. I'm your brother. I'm your friend. Second time, Jesus asks again, do you have agape love for me, Peter? Are you willing to sacrifice your life for me? Jesus, I already said, I phileo you. I've got brotherly love for you. You're a great friend of mine. The third time, Jesus says, Peter, do you have phileo love for me? Are you my friend? And Peter says, oh, a third time he's asking me, am I his friend? What Jesus does for Peter is he gives Peter the opportunity. He's denied him three times. He gets to affirm him three times. And the love of Jesus is that he goes down to Peter's level. Instead of saying, Peter, you know, a third time, are you willing to sacrifice? You're obviously not, because you can't even say the word. No, he says, okay, let me move even closer to your level, Peter. You're my friend? good. And now, Peter, I want to warn you about how you're going to die. You're going to follow me so faithfully that you're going to be hung on a cross and you're going to die just like me. Peter, welcome back. Follow me. And Jesus is restoring Peter from this incredible, horrible sin that is breaking Peter up. And the only way that Peter will be able to preach on Pentecost is, number one, because the Holy Spirit anoints him, because Jesus has forgiven him. And Peter's accepted that. Friends, we need to be broken by our sins. And we also need to come and accept his forgiveness. The way to that forgiveness is through breaking, confessing, and letting Jesus love us at whatever level we're at. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to see Peter's story. Jesus, let him know right now the example that he is for us and the way it encourages us. And help us, Lord, that even when we've denied you, help us to be broken. And Lord, I pray for that. Not for us to ignore our sin, to take it lightly, to be like the kids playing sorry and not mean it. I pray, Lord, that you would break us. And in the process of breaking, that you would heal us. And that we would accept your forgiveness and follow you. In Jesus' name.